So welcome to episode 4. Da, da, da. I guess I don't need to do my own music because we have music that gets put in afterwards. But that's okay.
You could do your own.
I could do my own. Yeah. My name is Brandie Bradshaw. I'll be hosting this episode today. And with me, as always, is to my right, Kristal. Say hi.
Hello.
Hello. And to my left, Thaleia.
Hello.
Hello. Welcome here. Welcome here, ladies. We've had to relocate to a new position in the church building.
Several different times.
Several different times because of our busyness around the church for Christmas. There's music productions and things going on, so...
People drilling into walls. And music blaring at the sanctuary.
You'd think we built a new building and it's all done. There's nothing left to do. No.
So now we're hiding in the lounge downstairs, yes. Which is Checkers remade. If you haven't checked it out, it's a great place.
The youth lounge. Mm-hmm. So hopefully it's not too echoey. But
oh well.
Oh yeah. Oh well. Too bad we're here. We're doing it. Okay, so the big news this morning, or whatever time it is, I don't even know what time it is. It is the afternoon. Okay, most people, yeah. Is we've come up with a name. We've come up with a name for a podcast, and if you're ready, here comes the bonus podcast.
The extra and then the bonus.
There is the extra podcast, and now there is the bonus podcast. So thanks to all our listeners for all your suggestions. Some of them were horrible, and some of them were okay.
And we won't tell you which is which, because we don't want to hurt anybody's
feelings. No, not at all.
Or give anyone inflated egos.
No inflated egos, yep. And there's no gift card to give out because...
We don't have one,
and...
this one idea came up about 5 minutes ago.
Yeah, literally just...
Decided we need to decide.
We decided it needs a name. So it's the bonus podcast. So, welcome to our bonus podcast. Today we have, in our Did You Know section, we wanted to let you guys know about Christmas events coming up at the church. And Kristal, would you inform us about what's going on around Northview and in our community for Christmas?
Sure. We have a different idea this year. Sometimes we've had Christmas productions and different things going on at the church. This time we kind of wanted to have a combination of being out in the community and having places to celebrate at church. So the first one coming up next weekend, December 14th to 15th, is the kids' production.
Woohoo!
We're going to hear more about that later in the In My Opinion section.
Oh, yes. He's
going to talk to us about the kids' production. So that'll be Saturday night and Sunday. The services, the kids will be doing We Three Spies. After that, Christmas caroling in our community, December the 18th, which I think is the Wednesday night, 6:30 p.m. If you come here to the church, you should sign up ahead of time so we know how many groups, but come to the church. Johnny apparently is going to teach us how to sing, which one? We Wish You a Merry Christmas?
I believe so, yeah.
In Punjabi. So if we're in our neighborhoods.
Johnny will, or Dave?
I don't know.
Oh, Sunday. Please. I really don't think Dave is.
Or Imran?
Dave? Imran? Dave? I don't think Dave's going to be teaching us how to sing Punjabi.
Does Johnny know how to sing Punjabi?
I think he's been learning it.
No.
Have you been hearing that coming from the corner of the office?
No,
there?
It's way far away from where I sit.
You're close to the music section. Yeah. You know that stuff
better. So basically we're going to totally learn that in 5 minutes.
Wow.
Yeah.
And then go sing it perfectly.
And hopefully it's not really bad. But if it is, that's all right.
Just smile real big.
But we will have invitations to the Christmas program that can be handed out as we're caroling, and they will be in English and Punjabi.
Wait, so we're requiring people to sign up before they come for caroling?
Yes. Well, I think that would be advantageous.
That always goes well for Northview.
Well, you know what? There are already 40 people signed up as of last week.
What?
Which is amazing for Northview to have that many signups.
Yes, because in general, Northview doesn't sign up for anything ahead of time. Oh, sorry. That's
just a pet peeve.
That should be in my opinion section.
Yep, another time. That's
true.
People drive up to the men's retreat without signing up.
Yeah, exactly.
Just
show
up.
I'm here. Yeah. Christian love.
So the last Christmas thing before the Christmas Eve service is a Skeptics Cafe led by Andy Steiger on Is Santa Crossed Off Jesus Real? Is how it's advertised. 7 p.m. in Center Court. So that should be good.
And that'll
about apologetics on Santa Claus, Jesus. So
That's a youth night. Are the youth coming, or is there no youth event night?
No, there is. The pastorates are having either Christmas parties, or some of the older groups were encouraging them to come to the Skeptics Cafe.
That's good.
Or they might go to caroling that week. It's kind of up to them on the youth.
Sounds good.
Thanks for plugging the youth there.
Well, I was going to bring my kids to that.
The Skeptics Cafe?
Yeah,
Pastorates. 1,000%. You're hearing it from my lips. If you, as a family, want to do something on a Thursday night that is like that, that is growing in education, please take your kids to that.
Well, I'm coming. Mark and I are coming with
you
our
have
kids.
My permission. Please don't be like, oh, you go to your pastor party. No.
Or I'll take a van full of kids.
Yes. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. Okay. Oh, sorry. Praise night's not till Friday. Sorry.
I can't say hallelujah yet. And then Christmas Eve services are going to be 4 different ones. I think it's 1:30, 3, 5, and 6:30.
Which, new times.
Yes, and all of us pastors will be at all of them. So you can come visit us at anyone, depending on which one you come to.
Yes.
And there will be a great Christmas photo.
Directors don't have to be at any of them. But I will be
but
at
you
all of
them.
No, yeah, I do. I like to play that card, but... I love being there. I love being at the door at every Christmas Eve service. Yeah. Smiling
like
and
so
welcoming.
Awesome.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Love it. Love it. So good. Okay. Well, so there's all your Christmas events. And our intention, I said this when I was hosting the Center Court services, that it's not that you attend all of those events. Please don't. That would be a lot.
That would lead to Christmas angst.
That would lead to Christmas angst, which is a wonderful segue, Pastor Thaleia Swaski. Thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you. That was like a volleyball just set right above the net for me to just slam it down. Yes, our topic today is Christmas angst. So right off the bat, we need to know what that is.
Yeah.
What is angst, Thaleia?
So I said that around the office this past week. I kept at lunchtimes bugging people saying, what is Christmas angst? And they like, what do you mean? To me, Christmas angst means that pit in your stomach that's full of dread and turmoil and anxiety and frustration when you think of the whole Christmas season. So I took a poll around the office and among my friends when I went for coffee with them. And here are the top reasons for Christmas angst. And you guys can add what you think. So family gatherings. By far, took number one. Then shopping for presents, number two. Food prep and finances probably were tied for number three. Decorating number four, although a lot of people are done with that. So that angst is done.
That's the pre-Christmas angst.
Yes.
The November angst.
Yes.
Then.
Pre-season.
Yeah.
Pre-season.
And the biggest word that came up among angst, that turmoil pile of pit stuff, is expectations. Everybody was worried about the expectations that their parents might have of them or their in-laws or their kids. You know, would their kids like the present they bought? Expectations around maybe attending all the church events or just some. Expectations about everything to do with Christmas. And it's an extra layer of busyness that's already added onto the regular busyness of life. So it's an intense time of year, and it brings up a lot of turmoil.
I have angst just listening to that list.
Yeah.
Give me angst.
Yeah. I'm surprised that family gatherings were at the top. Do you think that was actually...
Yeah, that didn't surprise me, because
okay.
You go to family gatherings and you feel like you have to wear the right outfit to the right event, show up at the right time with the right food and the right presents, and your kids have to behave right, and so does your husband, and you have to say the right things to the right people, and it's just a lot of expectation. And then a number of my friends are separated or divorced. So then you add in making sure that the kids go to visit all of their families, mm-hmm. and then how do you split up the holiday if... your parents are divorced, then how do you do Christmas Day, Christmas Eve, Boxing Day, and you're shuffling around all over Abbotsford or maybe even the Lower Mainland trying to visit everybody. So it's just this ball of, oh my goodness, how do I make this work? So I think, yeah, it's really hard for separated and divorced families or kids that have separated divorced parents.
Yeah. I wasn't really understanding that until you just said that.
Yeah.
All of a sudden now I'm like, oh.
Yeah.
That's... kind of gives me anxiety.
Yeah. So I met for coffee with one friend who's trying to figure out, okay, so they'll be at their dad's Christmas Eve and then I'll get them Christmas morning. And where are we going to meet to pick them up so it's a good drop-off pickup? And then we're going to go to this event and then he's going to go back and have them on Christmas Day. And then it's just it's just a ball of,
yikes.
Oh my goodness.
And especially if relationships are strained because you're separated or divorced, right?
Yeah.
Then there's lots of hurt feelings, probably unintentionally or whatever. Yeah.
And what about the equity for presents?
And then everything becomes shared, Christmas this year, but no Christmas next year with dad's family or mom's family.
And then there's angst for people who don't have family here. Or a family has passed away this past year. So all of a sudden, you're really missing that person. You can't celebrate with them. So everything has to change. Traditions and events have to change, and it's pretty tough. It's a really tough time of year.
Yeah.
And the expectation is that this is a fun time of year, a joy-filled time of year.
Right.
So we should go to plays and movies, and we should do all the fun things. But you know what? There's a lot of prep that goes into fun things.
And then you have, in your world, you have both of these people. You have people that aren't having a bad time and are going and are joyful and wee. Yeah. And then you have other people that are in the depths of despair.
Yeah.
Like, and especially even seeing this in the church. Like, so we have people in all of these different spectrums and situations. So,
yeah.
I mean, Thaleia, you've been thinking about this. So what's sort of some of your... solutions to some of this, some of the issues, some of the...
Yeah. I know that a lot of people aren't coming to see me right now in December because they are so busy.
Mm.
But I know that in January, I'll see a lot of people because when I worked in mental health, that's a really tough time. As the expectations have maybe fallen flat or they didn't rise to what they were supposed to be. So then people are really upset in January.
Or stuff came up at family gatherings that people have to process.
Right.
Yeah.
And why am I still reacting to this after 3 years?
And, if you haven't seen people and then all of a sudden it's an opportunity to like, oh, we have some news to share or there's something that happened or...
And you think of being a kid. When I was a kid, now this isn't everybody's experience, but you just show up to Christmas. Kids don't have that many things that they need to do, but parents have to make Christmas happen. So they have to shop and they have to make the food and they have to grocery shop and they have to decorate the house. The parents have to do it all in order for Christmas to happen. But kids just show up. So the expectation has changed as you get older. And that's kind of hard.
You want to just show up.
You want to be forever a child. I still have like some family gatherings where I can bring the carrots. And that's awesome. Oh. I love that. Like I have never had to make a big turkey yet. I just show up with the carrots or the salad. I just sign up for one of them.
I'm even married and I've had to bring the turkey before. Wow.
So
that's a blessing.
That'll be a shocker, but I actually have to do it. Yeah, you might as well enjoy that.
Yeah. Totally enjoy it. Enjoy that while you got that. Yeah.
She's
going to
be ordering pizza. Wow. Sterling's already had to bring the turkey, and she's like half my age.
Yeah.
I'm like, I have it easy.
Yeah. Sterling, your admin assistant.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Oh, man. Wow.
So, I have lots of solutions.
Yeah.
Some of it is very self-important. Right?
Like yes.
I remember one of a lady that I knew years back that lived near us, she would just be so just, oh, I just hate this time of year because I have to do this and I have to do that and I have to do this.
Yeah.
I'm like, you really don't have to. Like, you're choosing to do it and then you're saying you have to. Like,
yeah.
There's a certain amount of choice we have over these things. And so I think people need to realize that, there is a busyness and it is part of life, but you have choice over what you commit yourself to. And
Yeah, because that was like flavored all over your list and everything. You kept saying have to. That stood out to me too. What do you mean have to? I don't respond well to when people tell me I have to do things.
Well, a lot of people try to be like a supermom.
Totally.
Brandie, you have to do this podcast.
No.
But people try to be like supermom, right? So people will, sort of make a number of different items, but you could go buy it, for example. So you can manage the angst. So what I tell people is you can totally control the angst. I put a little joke in there where I say you put a leash on the angst and don't feed it too much because your angst is your buddy for the season. It's just how it is. And so if you don't feed it too much, then like out of control angst means tears, headaches, stomach aches, unnecessary arguments, temper tantrums, blow-ups, you name it. That's out of control angst.
Melt down.
But if you control the angst, then you can have a reasonable Christmas season. So we don't necessarily buy everything. Maybe you make some things, or maybe you buy instead of making it home.
See, I know. I was just going to say, this is where we tie in our social media podcast a couple of weeks back and say how much Pinterest has like grown probably the Christmas angst for a lot of people. Because I would say like in my, on my age range in the 30s, 40s, there's this like Pinterest, like make your own garland and make your own, because you can't just go now. It's not okay to just go to like Canadian Tire and buy a garland. Like, you have to be like, oh, where'd you get that? Oh, this really chic boutique store in downtown Vancouver. You don't know about it. We're like, oh, I got it from Portland or Seattle. Or I ordered it on Etsy. And like it just, you yeah, can't no. just have, like, well, I got it at Walmart. Yeah. Just, like, that's just, like, no. No.
You're just not cool.
Yeah, I tore down my own barn and I made it out of barn wood. Oh.
That's good.
Oh, that's unique. Pinterest has grown the angst in the women's category. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. And recognize we don't have to go to every event that's out there. And you don't have to watch every Christmas movie or every Christmas play. You can choose a few things this year. And next year you can choose a few different things. Because it gets a little overwhelming when every weekend you could be busy going from one thing to another.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and how important, like, some things like tradition are. And how that can give you angst, yeah. right? Like, but we always do this.
Yes.
But we always, like, that's a tradition. Like, well, maybe some of your traditions are causing angst
yeah.
and stress for not only you, but your whole family.
Yeah.
So maybe evaluate
shake
that.
It up. Yeah. Maybe change
maybe
it up.
Evaluate that a little. Yeah, have a little family meeting about yeah. that.
Like traditions of doing things and then also certain days. Like, I know some people are like right. totally set, like, we cannot yeah. celebrate any other day. And so then their kids get married and then it's this big stress. Like,
yeah.
For me, I don't care. Like, I mean, my kids aren't married yet, but I'm assuming that when they're, I can say, well, whenever it works. Like,
yeah.
Christmas
yeah.
does not have to be Christmas Eve yeah. or Christmas Day or, like,
yeah,
you know, it's just not worth it. But people yeah. get so tied.
They do.
It has to be our family on this specific day yeah. at this specific time.
And then that's a problem, yeah. too, because what about including people who don't have family around or who are new right. to the area or are yeah. hurting in some way? Because if you have to have only your family on Christmas Day, then there's no room for other people. And that's not part of being a Christian.
Yeah, if only Jesus had said something about family. We could talk about.
And I should clarify that. And it's not necessarily wrong to only have your family at an event. It's just that exclusive attitude where at all events, it's only family and there's no room to include other people.
Yeah. No. I mean, Jesus widened the circle of family. Like, that's what he did. You know, mm-hmm. Who's my mother? Who's my brother? These are my mother. These are my brothers and sisters. Yeah. yeah. These are my people. So it's not this... can, especially Christmas, I think, can bring up that potential idolization of family and yeah. it being your blood relatives and your...
Or yeah. I think if we really want to honor Christ, we need to think about who in our circles is alone or who's hurting or who's new
yeah.
or who can be included to something. Like, even for these Christmas events for church, bring someone along
yeah.
that hasn't gone to any events yet or doesn't have family around or who's new. Bring them along and include them in yeah. some of these church events. It'd be great.
And continue to talk to them after Christmas.
Yes.
Don't let them be your little Christmas, your little Christmas tangle. Yeah, your little Christmas tag along. Don't add it to your angst of have to's.
No.
Like, oh, to be a good Christian family, we have to invite some sort of person who smells to our Christmas banquet.
No. know,
But that's what it can happen, right? When we keep thinking about it, we keep thinking about Christmas being about us, it can happen that we just, even with our Christian things, we add it to, like, oh, I have to do Advent readings with my family, and I have to do, yeah. and I have to. Like, even within the Christian world, it can become this list and this
yeah.
legalism of Christmas celebrations, which is...
But then that's
wrong.
Christian Christmas angst.
Christian Christmas angst.
I have a new category.
New category. Okay.
So when you had the newlyweds, because you taught at the newlyweds mm-hmm. this Friday, what kind of things, did they have anything specific, or were you talking?
We were talking about how to work with parents and parents-in-law when it comes to the Christmas season as part of the event.
Yeah.
Because it's really hard when you're a newlywed couple, and you're trying to figure out where do you fit in terms of being a newlywed couple and also fitting into your parents and parents-in-law.
Yeah, hold on. Yeah. Tell us about the newlywed. What are you talking about?
Oh, okay. So
just
once a month on a Friday.
Give context.
Yeah. Once a month on a Friday, John Pazook and I teach the newlyweds about a variety of different topics.
John Pazook being one of our teaching associates.
Assassination.
He's a teaching assassinator. Word of God. Oh, I can see it now. The trailer.
Yeah, great.
Okay, sorry. You and John Pazook lead this ministry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we have 20 couples or so that are newlyweds, and we have about 10 I call them oldie wed couples. These are couples who've been married 15 plus years. Oldie wed. Yep. And they sit among the newlyweds and they just give perspective.
So what's the in-betweens?
Well, I wanted to call them mentors, but they didn't want to be mentors yet. They just wanted to be conversation participants.
Oh, people hate that word mentors.
I know.
They just get scared. They have to have an altar.
So then if I call them oldie weds, everybody laughs.
Yeah. Newlyweds and oldie weds.
Yeah.
And so just weds in the middle? Wed, you're just a wed.
You're not a new, you're not an oldie.
No. You're just a wed.
So if you're a newlywed listening to this, the next one is the end of January and they're talking finance.
Nice.
Yeah. But yeah, that's cool. One of the things, especially when you're a young couple, like, and you don't know your in-laws that well, and you don't want to get anybody freaked out, and you don't want to say the wrong thing. And yeah, so that's an extra level of stress. Yeah.
Score being single. No Christmas angst over here. Whee!
So what would be angst in the single realm? Like, just because you don't have any, there must be some.
I know, there's probably single people that would hate me to be like, well, I have single, you know, angst, because I'm probably loneliness is one, but again, I don't have that. I'm sure that that's one. Definitely there's a lot of friends that I have that I try to encourage and be like, you know, because a lot of times what happens, I think it's the problem with all of this, is it becomes, Christmas becomes about me and my expectations. And, like, it's about me having a good time. And so then it's like, well, I'm not getting invited to, like, no one would invite me to somewhere and no one's inviting me. And I'm like, well, what is your problem? Well, if you want to go hang out with those people, go and ask what's going on for Christmas. Like, go and say, like, hey, are you doing a Christmas thing? Can I come? Like, what's wrong with that? And I agree on some level, yes, in general. Singles probably aren't, you know, included, and there could be some encouragement on marrieds and families to include singles. I, in general, encourage all marrieds. Like, if you don't have singles in your life, like, you need some singles. Like, I mean, I have my marrieds, and I love my marrieds, and I'm like, they're token, yeah, friends, and then like token singles. Like, I actually have probably have now more marrieds than single, which is, that's the way it goes, right? As I get older, as I continue to be single. I have more married friends than I do single friends, but
at least they're still your friends.
Yeah, and they're not weird. Like, they're not weird married people who are like, ooh, we're married and, like, so we can't do things, you know, we can't talk about things. I mean, there's some things I wish they wouldn't talk about in front of me, but but yeah, no, I don't have, but I guess some of that angst still exists, like the decorations and all those kind of things probably still exists within the, sometimes I feel like, especially the single female, becomes this issue of, like, showing what a good wife or mother you would be.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
As, like, a dating technique?
Like, yeah, almost. Almost. Yeah. Like, you know what? Picture. It's like a competition of home-baked goods for the single guys that are still available.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I'm not even kidding you. It's, like, literally, sometimes I'm just, like, sitting there just laughing. These single guys.
My face is just looking. Like,
I know. It's just, appalled. Yeah, it's looking appalled. But seriously, because, like, yeah, these single guys probably have no clue. Like, girls, like, you know, hear these myths of, like, you win a guy, you know, his stomach and whatever. So these girls are making, like, cookies and everything for their guy friends that they're not interested in. Yeah, whatever, you're interested in them. And they make these, like, cookie things or, like, whatever. Or, like, yeah, come over, I'm having a... Yeah, yeah. And we do. We have our little singles Christmas parties.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like the married ones better. Usually involves kids, and kids are fun.
Kids are lots of fun, especially teenage kids.
Yeah. Yeah, but I generally, my personal thing with the Christmas angst is like, man, it's just not worth it. Mm-hmm. So that's why I'm hosting today's episode and not, I don't have a lot of practical advice. My practical advice is get over it. That's my practical advice.
Not bad advice.
My practical advice is get over it and love Jesus. Like, just be okay. It's gonna be okay. It's going
to
be okay.
Kristal, you had some good things to say before about your perspective on it.
Yeah.
In terms of theological perspective.
Yeah.
Well, I was trying to find an exact verse or something that I would go to, and I don't really have one specific to this, but I think anytime I'm in that situation where I'm feeling panic or stress or expectation, is think, what are the eternal moments in this, and what's going to, you know, what's insignificant eternally? And I think even, like, cleaning my house, like, that is going to be dirty again in an hour. I know that's but the way I am with my kids as I'm cleaning the house is going to last forever. Like, they're going to remember mom was always stressed, or they're going to remember mom talked to me as she was cleaning the house, right? Or as she did the dishes, or as she did homework with me, or whatever. So I think it's keeping in check with that attitude, and also, like, what is going to last? What's going to last is the impression you leave on people, the relationships that you build. All those kind of things. The things to do, like the cookies you bake, are going to be eaten right away. Is whatever, right? So don't get stressed about those things. Just think of the things that are, those things that are going to leave the lasting legacy impression on people.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that makes a difference. You were talking before about family gatherings.
Yeah.
You would go to a gathering.
Like for sure. Because I mean, as much as I get over it, there's definitely, there's issues, there's stress, there's complications in relationships. And even if your family is not Christian and you're going to family gatherings, you're a believer. You carry a gospel witness with you wherever you go. And so it's how you respond to, you know, that Uncle Willie who no one likes in your family gathering, and that you show great love to him because you've been shown great love.
Yeah.
Because Christ first loved you, you show great love. Mm-hmm. So as much as angst is out there, we as Christians need to respond to that with the gospel, need to respond to that with the love of Christ that's in us, the Holy Spirit that's in us, and show that fruit of the Spirit at those family gatherings.
And a little practical thing in there, I would say, if you struggle at a family gathering and you know you can only hold it together for so many hours, limit it to only a few hours.
Hmm. It's good.
So that you don't freak out on them, because that's not a good gospel witness, as you're talking about.
Yep.
Yeah, so be realistic with your expectations on yourself and on other people. And,
yeah, we've made it in our family sometimes where we say, you know what, we're going to be leaving by 7:30 or 8 o'clock because we're kind of done by that point.
Hmm. Yeah. That's
not
good.
Always, but if you know that that's going to be a stressful situation, then do a good job for the few hours that you're there, and then go kindly and politely.
Yeah. How do you keep Jesus and the, you know, cliche reason for the season at the core of everything?
Yeah, and we also pray a lot as our family before we head to certain things that are stressful, so that we have the right attitude before we go. Sometimes even that whole week I'm praying ahead to find out, Lord, help me to ask good questions. Lord, help me to interact with everybody there in a way that honors you. Lord, help me to do a good job of helping in the kitchen and dishes and whatever else needs to be done, so that it is a good witness.
Yeah.
And talking through those things with your kids and family ahead of time, right? So that they're, because sometimes you can think them, but you haven't necessarily prepped everybody or everybody thinking on the same page. And acknowledging that, I think, especially for kids and stuff too, right? Sometimes they don't understand some of those dynamics, but if you can acknowledge it with them and problem solve with them. And,
and if they understand that we're going to be leaving by about 7:30 or 8 o'clock, they can hang in there that long too. And then they can quietly come and tell you, it's 7:30. We're going to say goodbye to everybody and off you go.
And then for those who are hurting, or, you know, you'd mentioned people who had lost loved ones, and I definitely think about people I know that. Like, what would be some of your, you know, tips for those of us who know people and have people in our lives who are, you know, going to be walking through a season of grief, and it's a new grief, you know, where it comes up with the Christmas holidays.
And sometimes we think we have to hide away and not talk about that topic because this is supposed to be the happy, joyful time of year. But it's great if you can simply go to that person and say, I am so sorry that you lost so and so, and how are you doing, and how are you making it through this season? What are you doing for, you know, to cope? What are you doing to manage? What are you doing to celebrate? Talk to them about the loss. Talk to them directly about it. Don't hide from it. You can use a person's name. Talk about how much you miss that person if you knew them.
Yep.
And because they're thinking about the person all the time anyways.
Right.
And so we might as well just speak into that.
Yeah.
It's huge. I know I've had that happen last year, and someone just, she just thanked me for even just asking, because some people don't want to ask, right?
Right.
They're scared to bring it up.
And, yeah.
And it doesn't matter if they cry.
No.
Like, they're crying inside all the time anyway. So if it leaks out, it's like, that's okay.
It's good.
The tears are worth it.
Yeah.
Like, if I died, I would love it if my family walk around in tears. Right? I'm hoping that I'm worth it to them. Cry away.
Oh, mom's gone. Okay.
That's right. So the tears just tell you that the person's worth it. Brandy's freaking out.
Sorry. But I think, too, some people don't want to talk about it. But I think just allowing people to know that you're open to talking. Mm-hmm. Like, I usually try and kind of put a little,
like, a fishing line
out there and say, you know, I'm opening the conversation. If you want to go further, that's fine. If you just shut the door, that's fine.
Yeah.
But at least say, I'm open to it.
And don't have expectations when you're talking to that person that you're going to somehow alleviate their grief in some way. You know what I mean? That, like, you'll somehow, like, I get the heart of, I want to do something to bring them joy this holiday season, but realize that, you know, joy in Christ is deep and not always expressed the way our world sees joy expressed. And so someone can be going through a time of grief and loss and yet still have joy in Christ.
Absolutely.
In the holiday season. But it might not look like, Christmas lights and bells and
not expect people to have it all together. I know some people say people keep
saying, you're okay now, right? You're okay now. And like,
yeah.
Well, no, I'm not.
Yeah.
But there's this expectation that if I'm not, then that's bad.
Then right? That's
like,
bad.
Just
not, yeah.
You know, just be okay.
But yeah. Like, yeah.
Just still struggle. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So kill those expectations. Kill them.
Yeah.
Kill them, kill them, kill them.
At least manage them.
Yeah. Goal, step one, manage
expectations.
Kill some of them.
Yeah.
Make a goal to kill at least one expectation.
decide
which ones are important. And keep that, in, like Kristal said, that eternal perspective in mind. Okay, so quick prayer for our listeners, Thaleia, before we move on to our In My Opinion section. Pray for our angsters.
Yeah. Lord, you know that when I meet with a lot of women and couples and families, that there is a lot of angst and muck and difficulty. Lord, I pray that we will put you first and that we will seek you first and your kingdom and that you will help us to put this in perspective. Lord, I pray that also that you'll provide help for people, whether it's supportive family and friends, whether it's great worship music, whether it's a great Christmas event that brings you to the first, to the forefront. Lord, help us through this time, this busyness. Amen.
Amen. Okay, so to end off with the In My Opinion section, those of you who are center court attenders will have heard my mini rant on this maybe already.
Wow, you did it on stage.
A little bit, yeah. So
why does that not surprise you?
Why does that not surprise you? Yeah, they still keep giving me the microphone. I don't know what's going on there. But it's about the Northview Kids Christmas production. And I've seen this, as we said earlier, I'm standing at the doors. And so, well, that's for the Christmas Eve service. But for the kids production, I've been around and I see people walk into the church, see that it's the kids production, and hightail it out of there.
Oh.
And this is what I said. This is what I said on stage. I said, and I just want to slap you. Because what are you doing? What are you doing? This is like, we're church. We're a family. We are a family. I don't care if you don't have kids or grandkids or whatever in this production. The kids have worked hard. Their parents have driven them numerous times here to practice, to do all this. And these kids are expressing their faith in Christ in a beautiful, innocent, and wonderful way. And I'm always humbled by their expression of faith during these productions.
Mm-hmm.
Not only that, but it's freaking hilarious when a kid like falls off the choir rosters or something.
Or someone grabs the microphone, or
the preschoolers, you know, the preschoolers get up there on the Christmas Eve services and they're just looking all, they don't know the songs and the teachers are singing louder than they are.
It's just so awesome.
It's such a great, great thing. And so to choose not to be there, because it's sort of the church is about me kind of attitude, a little bit, you know, that sort of like, oh, I'm not gonna get anything out of this, there's no sermon, so I'm gonna go, is like talk about angst. That gives me a little bit of angst.
Okay,
gives
you a bit of anger.
I got a little bit of
I know for me growing up, that was kind of where I felt part of the church as a kid. Like when I could actually do something on stage and participate and be kind of the one leading the adults, it made me feel as a kid like, wow, I am part of this.
Totally.
And my faith matters. And I remember songs and verses and stuff from when I did productions that are like still with me today. Like that is a whole spiritual formation thing. These productions, these kids are listening to songs about, like in spring productions, they've done like Nehemiah and they've done like Bible stories and like, they're learning facts about the Bible and being able to just be part of that body.
Yeah.
And that's so important as kids get older. You don't want them to graduate from high school and
graduate from church.
Like they want to you want them to feel like they have contributed to the body, and that's one way they start.
This is and this is a huge way our kids get front and center in our church.
Yeah.
Like, hey, remember, there's kids here.
We don't see them a lot of times.
Yeah,
town,
totally.
Yeah.
And so like parents, it's probably a no-brainer and an obvious like, all right, there's kids here. But there's tons of us that don't have kids that go to Northview. And it's like, you need to be at these things. Like you need to, you're part of their faith growth. Your applause of their singing and their work and their time and their faith is huge affirmation to them. Huge encouragement.
And even older, like my kids are out of that age now, but my youngest, Trevor, he's 13. He's like, I can hardly wait to go to see the kids' production. Like, he just loves it. Right?
Yes.
And I think that just even the older kids encouraging the younger kids, too.
So,
we're here to value what you're doing.
Totally.
So, come out.
Come.
That's next weekend, right? The 14th, 15th.
14th, 15th. Northview
spy,
Kids Production.
Something about
We Three Spies.
Okay.
Yeah, very good. A lot of work goes into those, so yeah. Good. We'll see you out.
Excellent.
So that's it. Next podcast. Ezra's coming. We're going to be talking about New Year resolutions and get our pastor of prayer and discipleship in here to give us some practical tools for some of those. So, yeah. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.